You said, and you told me before, there was more connection with the forest, really.
Oh, for sure. For sure. And you know, it's not like I sat down and said, oh, okay, now I'm going to be a barefoot runner and hiker. It's just I did this first hike and I was like, well, I got to try this in the Catskill. And then I was like, okay, I got to do more of this. And I think it's, you know, it turns any barefoot turns any kind of run or walk or hike into an adventure, even if it's short, because you don't know what you're going to encounter. You got to pay attention, very intense, and you have to use that full body movement. And I just gradually just lost interest in running or hiking in shoes. So I won't wear shoes out in hiking or running, except in the winter. And or if I'm, you know, if I have to be somewhere and I'm falling behind, you know, hey, those are the only times I'll wear shoes now.
Awesome. That is wicked. So cool. And that's
wherever you go in the Catskills, you could look down and imagine glaciers below you.
I think the weather challenges on this incident were particularly difficult.
Whereas Panson Mountain is totally opposite. It's a mountain on top of a crater.
It is really the development of New York State. Catskills were responsible.
Yeah. Welcome to Inside the Line. The Catskills. All right, Ken, welcome to the show. How you doing?
Hey, Stash, I'm doing great. Thank you for having me on your show.
You're welcome. I'm excited about this. I'm really interested to hear about everything. But I got a question beforehand. Have you seen a cougar while out on the trails?
I'm not sure I'm allowed to answer that question.
Do you hear all the controversy online and stuff like that?
There's no controversy to those of us who are in the know.
True, very true. That's a good one. Yeah, I got alerted the other day that there was a mountain lion spotted below Giant Ledge at night somehow, below it.
You know, I heard a rumor that there's a black ops volunteer unit that you know coordinates with DEC, but it's not acknowledged, and they send these out whenever there's a cougar sighting to see if it's for real. But that's just a rumor.
That, and they trap it right there, right? I'm guessing
they might.
They go in operative. I like it. Well, I've heard of them. I've heard of the DEC dropping them in the forest and then by helicopter and then leaving. Stealth helicopter, by the way. Well, excellent. I'm glad we got that out of the way, Ken. Ken, welcome to episode 41 of Inside the Line, the Catskills. I appreciate you for joining me.
Thank you, Steph.
Yeah, this is going to be a great discussion with you. Ken hikes barefoot. I just had an episode with the fastest known time of the Devil's Path, and I thought he was crazy, but I think you're getting there on the crazy and cool list, like at least at the top.
We'll see what you think here in a minute.
So thank you, monthly subscribers, Darren White, John Comiskey, Vicky Ferrer, Jim C., Michael Bonger, Alec Betancourt, and Sarah Bacon. Thank you, everybody, for contributing to the show. Ken, are you having anything to drink tonight, sir?
Yeah, I had a glass of water, Stash.
Excellent. Got to stay hydrated. Definitely. Have you been on any previous hikes in the Catskills in the last week or so? Can you tell me your story about them?
In the last week, no, I haven't been in the Catskills since I finished my All Trails Challenge, which was about a month ago.
Oh yeah. Well, I think I have that on the agenda. We better have that on the agenda. Yes. Okay. Yep. Excellent. Yeah. Where did you finish on again?
I finished, well, the Catskills All Trail Challenge, you know, is just covering all the trails. So mm-hmm. We went up the slide afterwards, but there was a little fragment of trail between the main trail up slide and the Curtis Ormsby. So that 0.8 miles was all that was left. So that was the official finish. And then we went up the slide and got chased off by black flies.
Yeah, of course. They're thinning off right now, but still, those things are vicious.
They can be.
Yeah, I recently went up Catskill High Peak with my friend Jason and celebrated his grid finish. So that was pretty cool.
Oh, and I was so sorry to miss that because Jason and Luna and some other friends were at my All Trails finish. And really the reason I did the All Trails is I knew about it. But the first time I met Jason and Luna, you know, Jason talked about it. And sometimes you meet somebody and you hear something cool they did and then it clicks and you're like, yeah, maybe I should do that too.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, Jason did his All Trails, right?
He's done it twice now, once by himself, once with Luna.
Whoa, insane. I got to ask him his mileage because hopefully he's tracking this, all this, because you and him and Jim Boughton and Ralph have got to be the creators of the Catskill or something like that. It's insane.
I'll tell you something funny, because Jim is in, Jim and Ralph are in a higher dimension than I am. I was finishing up my grid. I think I was within two or three of finishing it. I was up on the, you know, on the, not the whole nine, but the six, right? From Friday to Peekamoose. And I think it was Lone. I got there and in the canister, there was this message. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to me. I'm done with grid three.
That was Jim's message to you or to himself?
That was his message to whoever happened to open the canister and look at the logbook.
Oh, God. Three? So that's, good Lord, 560 or 1,560?
I can't do that kind of math.
Good Lord. What a, oh, no, it's around 1,200 and something, but insane.
1,260, I think.
Yeah, 1,260. Okay, my bad. Bad math. That was four grids, but amazing. Amazing. You guys are crazy. I don't know if I'll ever be able to do that with these knees.
Oh, I hear you. My knees are getting older. They ain't what they used to be. So be nice. This is July is be nice to knees month. I just declared right now. So
because of the humidity?
No, just because my knees need some extra love and care. So I don't know how to get
them. Ice all the time. Trust me. Excellent. Well, yeah, I'm glad to celebrate Jason's grid finish. Was pretty cool. Luna is awesome. I had some great people up there, Rob and Linda. He was asking me about podcasts. He says he never can listen to a podcast. And I told him, you'll be able to listen to it. And it was funny. It was a good conversation. But we also had Mike Sudi up there. It was really cool to listen to his stories.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, he's also in another dimension. Mr. Diratissima. Very, very impressive.
Yeah, insane stuff. You guys are all awesome.
For sure. I'm biting my tongue because I've got stories about Mike Sudi too. Because if you spend enough time in the Catskills, you're going to run into him. But I think you said it really well, Stash. You said great people, and I think the mountains bring out the best in people. Typically, that's my experience.
Oh no, agreed. It seems like the ones that spend the more time have that, like, that vibe that you can feel, that they're always happy, doesn't matter what, when they're in the mountains. And it, you know, it was a great time between everybody. Everybody was just talking, you know, hearing Mike's stories are absolutely insane. It's crazy stuff. And I guarantee you have some crazy stories that we'll share tonight.
Well, you might, if you torture them out of me, but you're welcome to try.
So once again, I talk about volunteering a lot. Catskill 3500 Club has trailhead volunteers, still days open Saturdays and Sundays, and on Fridays and Mondays when they're holidays. Check it out. Please sign up. We need as many trailhead stewards as we can get. There is also the Catskills Trail Crew, a very awesome organization run by my friend Matt Smith and Charles. I forgot his last name, Goodle. They basically refurbish trails as much as they can in the Catskills, and they need as much help as they can. I really wish I had weekends off and I would be on the trails with them helping out as much as I can, but I don't have that. But they've been doing an awesome job. They just finished part of Huckleberry Point, which has been underwater for a very long time. It's a very muddy, crappy area, so hopefully this will refurbish that. And they did a great job on the long path. They did a great job on Plateau Mountain. They have been kicking some ass lately, and it's awesome. So, wicked. So, Ken, you want to hear a tiny bit of Catskill Mountain history, buddy?
Of course.
Let's go. No, coming to the Catskills in the mid-1800s, tourists arrived mostly by train. The trek couldn't take as long as much as a day from Manhattan, which meant middle-class families who ventured there often stayed a week or more, especially during the summer. The mountains were a haven for painters. Women wore blue flannel dresses and waterproof cloaks, as opposed to the frippery of the Madison Square Park, and climbed steep gorges with sketchbook, paintbrushes, and pencils in hand. Artists painted out of doors. The romanticism of nature was meant to evoke a feeling of otherworldliness at the sublime. They too wanted to capture what was left of New York's verdant forest after logging stripped trees for housing and railroads and tanneries as well, and cleared the land of eastern hemlock whose bark was used for tanning. In 1896, a physician, Alfred Loomis, founded a sanitarium in Liberty, New York, for tuberculosis patients who believed the cure for the disease was fresh air and rest. Though Loomis died before the sanitarium was Christian, its opening would have a chilling effect on summer travelers who was weary of making their path north with sick fellow passengers. As a result, the local economy stalled. "They were coughing and hacking on the train," said Stephen Silverman, who I had on the show, author of The Catskills History and How It Changed America. "The boarding houses were filled with consumption patients. People could not sell summer homes. Real estate plummeted. The Catskills quickly went out of favor." So yeah, that's it. That was a little short one. I just got that before you came on. That was a really crazy time. I remember talking about that, where everybody with tuberculosis went up north and somehow it healed, but it actually was the cool, vibrant air that they thought was healing them.
Yeah, it was a shame. I think thoroughed tuberculosis. A lot of people did that.
Back in the 1800s, it was a big thing, actually. And that's why people thought to go up north to the Adirondacks or the Catskills would be helping them out to go clean, crisp air, get out of the air of the New York City area.
Yep. I'm sure it helped, although I'm sure not. It couldn't help everybody.
Yeah, unfortunately. All right. So let's get on to my guest of the night, Ken Posner, and he hikes barefoot.
Let's go.
Let's take a long pause and put that through our brain and be like, holy crap, what the hell is he thinking? That's what we're going to find out tonight. We're going to find that out. So, Ken, you can take a background about yourself. Tell us about yourself.
Well, sure thing, Stash. And, you know, I've been living in New York for a number of years. And I used to do a lot of ultra running and had great fun with that. As I got a little bit older, you know, I backed off on that a little bit to preserve those knees and ankles and other body parts. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm a Gardner resident, and I do love the Catskills, and I do get out there as much as I can. You know, the All Trails Challenge was great fun to explore parts of the Catskills I'd never seen before, as was the grid. It's just about, as you put it so well, spending the quantity of time out in the mountains, quality and quantity, if you can.
Mm-hmm. Now, where are you from right now? Where are you living?
In Gardner.
Oh, sorry. I thought you meant you're a Gardner.
That's in Schwangun. So the Schwangun Bridge is right in my backyard.
Excellent. How long have you been hiking, like overall?
Oh, gosh. So I suppose about 40 years or more than that. When I was, I remember, you know, my family took us, we came to New Hampshire on vacation when I was 12. So that was a long time ago. And I remember we went up Eisenhower, I think it was.
Oh, wow.
You know, we were unprepared hikers, just rolled and walked straight up and through thick fog and never stopped to think about the weather on the ridge, and got there and turned around and came back and lived to tell the story. But I did an outward bound course in college, spent 4 years in the Army. So that was, now you wouldn't call that hiking in the Army, but it was a lot of, you know, it was light infantry and ranger type units. And so a lot of movement through forest and mountains and desert. And as I mentioned, you know, a lot of running, a lot of trail running. But I've just always loved getting out into the mountains or the desert, or down here in the Schwangunks, there's a patch of grassland, totally full of grass and flowers, and that's lovely too. What I don't particularly like doing is sitting in a chair staring into a computer, but that's my job. And so I do that like we all, most of us do. And this is the, you know, the antidote.
Like right now you're staring into the computer looking at me. Well, TV or cell phone.
That's right.
So, I've been looking at your Facebook and your blog and your Instagram. You recently went to the John Muir Trail. That's like a dream of mine. That is a very big dream of mine. Did you do the whole thing?
Yeah. So I've done the John Muir. I've been out there twice and I'm about to go out again. Spending all of my vacation days at work in August, just about. And so I'm going to go out again. The first year I did 150 miles barefoot out of the 210. The second year I did 170. So this year I'm giving myself a couple extra days and a better resupply plan. I'm going to try and do all 210.
Nice. What'd you think of it?
Oh, it's gorgeous out there. And, you know, it's spectacular alpine, you know, scenery, buck tree line with the shattered granite peaks and pinnacles. And you know, so it's very different from the Catskills, but, you know, my view is every natural environment is equally beautiful. But it's fun to get out there. I'm more of a tourist out there, but it's great fun. And you know, a through hiking experience like that, you know, I'll be on the trail for a week, take a break, and then I, you know, a couple or 3 weeks. So it is that chance to get into a different rhythm.
Do I get solo?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Awesome. That's crazy stuff, man. And barefoot. How is the walk through that compared to the Catskills?
It depends. There are long stretches on the John Muir Trail, particularly in the valley, where the trails are this beautiful, soft, silky granite dust. I mean, it's more beautiful than a beach, than any beach you've ever seen.
Oh, man.
Honestly, I don't know why anybody would wear shoes walking on those parts of the trail. But then there are the mountain passes, and then those tend to be piles of rocks. So it's much better than the Catskills in some places, and it's worse than the Catskills in other places. So it's intense.
Yeah, you definitely have those passes with the shale and everything like that. That's got to be fun.
Oh, yeah. What they have there is just granite cobbles, you know, broken apart with sledgehammers. And, you know, the worst part is when you're going downhill, because downhill is harder in barefoot because you can't jump and drop, you know, you got to lower yourself down. Yeah. And then you're going downhill on a south facing trail, right? That means you get the brunt of the noonday sun. So it's downhill, it's hot, and then you get that sprinkled sharp gravel, and then that can become quite difficult.
And a lot of swear words.
Yeah, that's the, you know, and barefoot is, I mean, barefoot is intense, and that's why I love it, one of the reasons. And you get that contrast between the difficult stuff, and it's, you know, Stash, it's frustrating, particularly if you're used to going fast and shoes. But when you're done with the difficult stuff and you get the moss or the silky, dusty sand, or you get the black mud in the Catskills up in the top, or you get that sandstone slab, which is so smooth, it might have been polished, then that's wonderful. And, you know, of course, you don't get that in shoes. Shoes turn everything, make things just that little bit more a little bit more monotonous, and yeah. You lose contrast. And so once the risk with barefoot is once you let your feet wake up again and you discover all these sensations, then you don't want to go back.
True. Wow. Crazy. So where else have you been, anywhere else in the U.S. hiking barefoot or even the world?
I haven't been outside of the U.S. recently, but I was up in New Hampshire. I'm working on the New Hampshire 48, 4,000 footers. So I've done 36 of those barefoot. And I've done the Adirondacks barefoot. And I've been out, I've been, you know, around Moab on the sandstone and
oh, nice.
Canyon and Capel Reef and Bryce Canyon. And there's a nice little state park in Utah. I think it's called Coral Pink Sand Dune State Park.
Yeah. I was just there a couple months ago.
Oh, were you really? Yeah.
Yeah. That's got to be awesome.
Yeah, that was fun. So those are the areas I've been. I haven't been everywhere. You can't get everywhere. I've done some running in a few. I mean, I was down in, I did a road race in Mississippi. I'm not sure roads there were particularly different from anywhere else. I was down, there's some beautiful grasslands outside of Dallas. I did a race there earlier this spring.
Oh, nice. I think, are you friends with Phil Vondra?
I know who he is.
He did a run down there, and I don't know if it was the same thing. It wasn't, I don't know if it was Dallas, but it was somewhere in Texas.
Well, I think he would have been so far in front of me, I might never have seen him.
Oh, God, no way. So you have a blog. It's called The Long Brown Path, correct?
That's right.
So what do you write about on that?
Well, you know, Stash, I write up some of my trip. I'm trying to become a writer. I am so far the most obscure writer that's out there, I think. I did write a book a few years ago about my experience through running the long path.
Nice. What's that called?
It's called Running the Long Path.
Oh, excellent. I'll put that in the show notes.
So I think with the writing, I'm trying to share that experience that a lot of us have out in the mountains, sort of the connection with nature, and what it means. I'm trying to put it into words. And it's hard, but I think that energy is so important, and it may be that so many people just have no interest or don't care, but I'd like to think that if you know, you reach them through your podcast, or maybe I reach them through my blog, and somebody else, like you were mentioning, the folks back then painting pictures, so, you know, we're all just trying to share the magic that's out there, and try and figure out why it means so much. Can we put that into words and help other people understand?
Yeah, it's called influence. You want to influence people, and a book or, you know, a podcast or a blog could do that. And it could change people's minds. Trust me. I mean, I'm thinking about this right now, walking barefoot, maybe on, you know, the summit of Plateau Mountain. Wonder what it would feel like. So maybe I'll do it sometime.
So I created the a Barefoot Hiking Academy, and I had my first student graduate.
Nice.
A little bit. That consisted of me spending an hour with her, Heather Housekeeper. She might be an interesting guest for your podcast. She's an herbalist, so she can tell you all plants. And she's also a veteran through hiker, done the Long Path, the Finger Lakes Trail, and others. So I took her out, and we spent an hour just to give her a chance to experience it. And it was fun. It was fun to see. You know, I have a few years of experience now, so I can move around a little bit. It's fun to see somebody just start taking those real baby steps and realizing that there are all sorts of other muscles that you tend to, it depends on who you are, of course, right? Some people have beautiful form in shoes, but it's different. And barefoot is going to start using different muscles immediately. And it's interesting just to see that, see the eyes opening and the body sort of coming awake and realize.
Crazy. So I'm guessing like we'll talk about that later. I was going to say you prepare yourself of different steps. So we'll talk about that later. So your book, Running the Long Path, you want to just explain a little bit about that? You ran the whole long path, 300 and something miles, correct?
That's right. And this was a few years back in 2013. I ran the long path and I wanted to go out. I had done a bunch of ultra marathons, but I had never done a multi-day run or a fastest known time. And so I became sort of intrigued by the trail. I saw the aqua blazes in one impairment. I saw them in Alaska. It dawned on me that there was this one trail that basically connects New York City and just about all the way to Albany. I became intrigued. And, you know, with some misgivings, I decided to go out and try and through run if I could beat the record. It was a tremendous experience, and I was saved by my wife because I tried to do it on a self-supported basis. I did not have enough food. So towards the end, I realized I might not be to the finish line. So she came out and rescued me with extra food. So it became a supported exercise, but it was just, you know, there were two things that were moving about the experience. The first was just the intensity of going out for 9 days, and pushing myself, you know, on average 40 miles a day, and, you know, the physical and the anxiety and the fear and the ticking clock and the questions about whether I was, you know, going the right direction. I did not have an app or anything like that. So, but then afterward, there was almost like a second experience because I was so curious about the things I saw, and I did some research, and I went back and I read about Walt Whitman and Thoreau and John Burroughs. There were these great voices from the past that, you know, are talking about the things that you and I and others feel about the importance of nature. And so in the book, I tried to weave those two things together, both my own experiences and what I had learned of the people who had been out on the trail or in, you know, historic New York, whether it was Walt Whitman and John Burroughs discovering, you know, the call of the hermit thrush, which Whitman put into some of his most famous poetry at Burroughs' suggestion, or Joseph Brant, who was the war chief of the Mohawks, and how he terrorized the Schoharie Valley back during the Revolutionary War. So I tried to weave these two themes together, and I had a lot of fun with it. And, you know, I helped to do some work over time. Although it's hard. It's hard to publish books, and it's hard to sell them. So.
Especially nowadays. I agree with you. And that's why I'm guessing you have a blog, is to get people to read a little bit and then be like, oh, wow, this is he does a great job. Let's purchase this book. So I will be purchasing your book.
Well, I'm delighted, Stosh, and I will be glad to sign it for you. And
yes, excellent. I'll get a barefoot lesson, and you'll be like, my God, this guy is such a wuss.
No, you'll get all of that. So,
rock on. Amazing. So,
and a big thank you.
Yeah. Do you have involvement with the New York New Jersey Trail Conference, correct?
That's right. I'm supervisor for the Southern Chuangunks, and I have a crew of 8 or 9 people who go out and keep those trails open. And I also serve on the board.
Nice. So you're helping out our trails. So thank you very much for that. So excellent. If you need some volunteers, let me know. I'll publish it on this anytime I can.
You mentioned Charlie Gadol, who's also a board member of the Trail Conference. And as you pointed out, he's been doing terrific work in the Catskill, just tremendous, tremendous work.
Yeah, please tell him if you see him that I wish I had more time to join him on the weekdays, because, you know, Matt Smith was a great friend of mine for the Catskill 3500 board. And me and him shared a lot of good ideas. And he said a lot of his influence came from me and what I wanted to do with the good old Catskill Clove area, because me and him, you know, wanted to get a team to attack those areas after a weekend, because, you know, they had, during the COVID times, they were crazy. Yeah. So we made a quick response team, and unfortunately it didn't really work out because there wasn't enough quick responders. So they made this trail crew kit thing, and I'm very proud of that. I am hoping to get people to sign up. I'm hoping to sign up one time. I wish I had time. It sucks.
Yeah. Time is the limiter for all of us. No question.
Yeah. So every time I do the show notes, I've post everything of volunteering in the Catskill, where it's Catskill Mountain Keeper, New York, New Jersey Trail Conference, Catskill Center, 3500 Club, whatever. We need to all have those volunteers. So I thank you for your help in the Catskills. It's awesome. So you've done a couple barefoot runs. Let's what barefoot runs have you done besides the long path?
Well, the long path was with shoes.
Oh, okay. But still.
And so I would say in the Catskills, it's mostly just hiking. So I've done a handful of, you know, races, 5Ks. I've done a few marathons. So I would say nothing particularly special, but trying to do more of that. You know, it's just so much fun to get out and run, whether you're fast or slow, short or long distance.
But you're also the organizer of the SRT, which is Chuangunk Rail Trail, right?
That's right. The SRT is the Chuangunk Ridge Trail, and it starts in Port Jervis at an intersection with the Appalachian Trail, High Point, High Point State Park, and it goes 70 miles north and finishes in Rosendale, just past the that trestle over the roundout. We have 3 divisions: the full 70 miler, then a 30 mile division, and then a half marathon. So, by the way, if anybody listening to the podcast is interested, please, you know, www.srtrun.com, and please reach out to me if with any questions. You know, Stosh, we make it a little more difficult. We make it a little bit more difficult. It's by design. It's not supported. So we have checkpoints to make sure we have accountability and safety, but we don't give you any food or water. You got to bring your own food and you got to bring a water filter. And the whole course, you know, takes place on blazed trails, but we don't mark them. So we give you an interview. So you got, if you're not sure you're on the right trail, you got to check the app. And, you know, it's as simple as Google Maps. You see, oops, I'm not on the trail anymore. So you go back on it. And we have search and rescue teams standing by because sometimes people get confused or tired or whatever. But it's a race where the fastest person doesn't necessarily always win because you got to be mindful. You've got to be able to manage yourself. So the reason we do this is we want to promote those values of, you know, self-reliance and self-management, which all of us use when we're out exploring on our own. We wanted to make that part of the race to make it a little bit different. And for, and by the way, I've run lots and lots of races with great aid stations and well-marked courses. So I'm not against that. Again, this is a little bit different and it makes it a bit of an adventure.
Yeah, it's definitely, I think our rescue to search and rescue team has volunteered for that, actually.
That's right. Yeah, the search, and they're all volunteers too. So SRT is now part of a not-for-profit. So we, you know, all the proceeds get saved and we use them. You know, some of them go to the search and rescue team. So we make contributions or we give it to the trail conference or we use it. We help the trail conference buy a little bit of land to improve the long path and the Schwangung Ridge Trail by the Vashakil. And we have room for Catskills runners to come on down and join us in the Schwangungs. The Schwangungs are different from the Catskills, but it's another magical zone in New York. You've got these, you know, white polished cliffs and the pitch pine barrens and the sky lakes. It's just spectacular. And the reason I came up with the idea for the race, I'd run that trail myself several years ago. And it was such a, again, like the long path, it was just such a special experience. I wanted to make it available to other people. So please come on down and join us September 10th if you can.
I look forward to it. You know, I've actually, I think a couple of my friends has done it. I remember my friend Greg did it, Greg Calabrese. He said it was brutal. And you guys do south to north or is it back and forth?
It's all point to point. It's all south to north.
Okay. I don't know. Me and my friend were hiking Catskill High Peak, and I remember they were going south. I don't know if it was at the long path run or something like that or something different, but a guy fell, ripped his leg apart, but he got up and he was perfectly fine and he ran it.
Yeah. You know, as I got towards the end of my, you know, let's say the aggressive phase of my running career, I tripped and fell. Not far from there. Where was I? I was on the other side of the ridge, coming down from North South Lake down towards Palinville. And right at the top, it's perfectly flat and level. And that's where I tripped.
Of course.
So, you know why I tripped? It's called trying too hard. So it's like after battling the rocks for miles, I'm like, finally, I can run. Boom.
You misjudged and you thought it was easy and all of a sudden they're like, nope, we're going to make this hard for you.
Yeah.
it's always like that. You always get to that last mile and a half of walkout and you're dragging your feet and you trip over something or you roll your ankle all the time. Happens every time.
Yeah.
I remember you sending me an email about your best run, your favorite run. Is that your best and your favorite? The Badwater Double, correct?
Yeah, that was I think that's my best run. And Stash, I'm not an elite runner, you know, I never run a race or you won't see me up in the front, particularly on the trails. But this was a good execution. I went out and I had a great crew and they made it possible. So we went out in 2014 and did the Badwater Double from Badwater Basin in Death Valley up to the summit of Mount Whitney and back. So that's 282 miles.
Whoa.
So I did that and I broke the record by a small margin. So, and I may still hold that record.
Wow.
Jeff Adams now holds the record for the long path. He came through, I think a year and a half ago or maybe a couple years and really did a great job. But the Badwater run was a great experience. That was probably the best, run of my life. And from that point on, it was, sort of all downhill. But that was a special experience.
So you went from Death Valley, which is 200 feet below sea level, to Whitney, which is 14,600 feet.
It's 14,500, I think. And I think Death Valley is 282, but yeah, basically. It's the lowest point to the highest point in the continental West. And then back.
Holy shit. Wow. I've never heard of that. Definitely going to put that in there. Wow. That is insane. And how many miles did you say that was?
I think it's 147, so 294.
Wow. How many days?
It took about 4 days.
Oh, about 4 days. It would take me about 3 years.
Yeah, well, if I did it now, it would take me about 3.5 years. It went well.
So you went desert to way above alpine. That's insane. That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And it was, you know, we felt the altitude. We felt the headache. So we didn't stay long up there. But we turned around and got off. The Catskills are lovely and wonderful, and in Death Valley and in the High Sierra are too, in a very different way. You know, I personally can't get enough of all of the above.
Correct.
You know, and I have to drag myself away and I have to work and, you know, be productive, but that's sort of where my heart is.
Wow. Awesome. Wow. I'm going to put that in there and I'm going to notify that in the show notes. That's crazy. So let's get on to the talk about the Catskills. We've been going back and forth about the Catskills. So you did all trails in the Catskills barefoot. Do you have any stats for that? How many miles was that?
I'm supposed to know that, aren't I? I think it was...
it's like 372 or something?
Like about 350.
Wow.
This was over a few years. I think I got serious in 2019. And I downloaded the spreadsheet. That's when I met Jason and Luna. And I downloaded the spreadsheet. And at that point, I think I had done about 40%. But I'll tell you, Stash, I had done a lot of the peaks. You know, I had done the grid at that point. So a lot of time on the high peak. I had never once, as far as I can remember, set foot in the Western Catskill. And the great thing about, you know, all trails is it forces you to go out and explore these trails you wouldn't otherwise. I had gone past the turnoff to Poets Ledge 1,000 times. And I was like, I'm not waste time going a quarter mile out and back. I just, you know, I'm in a hurry. I'm a runner. I've got to go from point A to point B. I've got to get up Catskill the umpteenth time. So it forces you to go out there and see all those things you never bothered to see. And you start to understand that seeing, you know, as we all understand, but seeing and experiencing is part of the journey. And the Western Catskills, I think, are just lovely. And they're not crowded at all.
You know, you can go
not see a person. Whereas, you know, try parking at Giant's Ledge on a nice fall day. Good luck, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah, the Western Catskills holds its own beauty because a lot of it, a decent amount of it, has old trail roads, and they are very special, aligned with the what is it called, the plantations, the pine plantations and stuff like that, and the muddy areas, the fern glades, the tall pines are just standing there. It's awesome, and I love the mud. I really love the mud out west. It's so nice. It's so nice in the Western Catskills. And to me, the fern glades are one of those things where you feel like, I always think of what's his name? And oh my God, it's drawn a blank, but where he's walking through the grass and just feeling the grass. God, what is that? Gladiator. Russell Crowe is walking through the grass. It's like that with the fern glades when he's like hallucinating that he's going to die.
I've had some experiences in fern glades. You know, some friends and I, did a hike. It was supposed to be up Balsam Cap, right, from Out of Breath Hill.
Oh, nice. Yeah, that's a great one.
But we were doing it differently. We did, we were going to do it natural navigation. So that means you study the map and then you put it away. You put your GPS in your pack, you put your compass in your pack, and you find your way. And that worked out great. except we ended up on Peekamoose instead of there was one point where we were just going through this really open ridge, which must have used to have been a farm once upon a time. And it was just an endless glade of hay-scented fern. And it was just such a special experience. I think a lot of times I have that experience that after fighting through the beach and the hobble bush and everything else that's trying to stop you, you get to this sort of opening and you just flow through it. It's that contrast again. And it's so special. I had a similar feeling, we did a bushwhack up panther in the winter once. And there was a beautiful ridge. It was just like a knife edge ridge. And we went back into the forest and we came out and there was this little clearing. And that's the last thing you expect in the Catskills. But we came out to this little clearing and the stars were shining down in the snow. It was just a really cool experience. Hey, by the way, I hear you on the mud on the Western Catskills. That would be, there's a reason they named it Mud Pond, right?
Yep. Mud Pond and Trout Pond.
Yeah. Trout Pond too is fun.
It's a beautiful place. A lot of people don't know about that, like you said, and it's a beautiful place to get away and to experience the Catskills, the Western Catskills by yourself, really. Nobody else.
For sure.
Yeah, I know that one spot on Panther you're talking about, by the way. That's a very special spot. So we won't talk about it much more.
Yeah, no grid coordinates.
Yeah, yeah. I know you've hiked the before barefoot, but before you started hiking barefoot, was there any like prep that you had to do before, or did you just go out and throw your shoes off and say, screw this, I'm doing it and I'm going to check it out?
Yeah, no, there, I mean, I got the idea from Born to Run. Right. And, I had gradually over the years, you know, transitioned from, you know, conventional big heavy shoes with big freaking, you know, cushioned heels. I had, you know, already transitioned to more minimalist shoes, you know, and sandals too sometimes. So that may have been helpful to me. But I got the idea for barefoot hiking because, you know, the thesis was Born to Run, that barefoot running is a more natural gait. And therefore, it would help you avoid injury. Now, that's a theory, okay? But I said, well, look, it makes sense to me. I'm going to give it a try. But why don't I just go for a hike? And then I take all the stress out, right? And I can work on natural form, moving barefoot, but at a slow pace. So there's, you know, very little risk to muscles, tendons, joints, et cetera. Because that was a time when I was starting to get more injuries. And so I was looking for something to do that was less stressful. So that's where the idea came from.
Nice. So you're saying going barefoot gives you less injuries because I'm guessing, you know, like rolling your ankle, breaking your ankle, stuff like that. Because of the rocks and stuff?
Well, so here's the theory. Distinction between my opinion based on my experience. There's no science here.
Okay.
Right? Because you can't get enough barefoot people together to, you know, to do it. Right? So, but you know, shoes, like any technology, there's a cost to them. They're going to change your gait. And what they make it easy to do is walk very heavily, right? With a heavy step, because the cushion and the Vibram or whatever you're wearing shields you from the sharp rocks and absorbs the force. So, you know, and Thoreau noticed this and John Muir noticed it. They noticed how Native Americans, you know, who as kids habitually went around barefoot and then they would wear, if anything, moccasins. They noticed how they moved differently. And so what barefoot teaches you is that moving naturally without that kind of protection on your feet, you can't slam your feet. No matter how tough your skin gets, right? It's never going to be as tough as a sharp rock, right?
Yeah.
So you can't do that. So you remember or you relearn, you know, if you're somebody like me, that you use your whole body to absorb the shock. So you use your core muscles, you use your abdomen, your calves and your arches and your feet. And you flex your knees and you walk in a little bit more of a crouch, and that protects the feet, but it's a very different way of moving. And the idea is that that's theoretically the natural way of moving, and the natural way ought to be the way that's going to present the least risk of injury. Again, that's a theory. Everybody's got to make up their own mind. I would say that's a theory, and that's why I tried it, but that's not why I kept doing it. I mean, the reason I kept doing it after it was just, I realized it was more fun.
Yeah. You said, and you told me before, there was more connection with the forest, really.
Oh, for sure. For sure. And you know, it's not like I sat down and said, oh, okay, now I'm going to be a barefoot runner and hiker. It's just, I did this first hike and I was like, well, I got to try this in the Catskill. And then I was like, okay, I got to do more of this. And I think it's, you know, it turns any, barefoot turns any kind of run or walk or hike into an adventure, even if it's short, because you don't know what you're going to encounter. You got to pay attention, very intense, and you have to use that full body movement. And I just gradually just lost interest in running or hiking in shoes. I won't wear shoes out in hiking or running, except in the winter. And or if I'm, you know, if I have to be somewhere and I'm falling behind and I need to pick up the pace, those are the only times I'll wear shoes now.
Awesome. That is wicked. So cool. And that's such a great of an answer to the question, because it's just, it explains the reason why you want to do this. It's just, it's really like, to a lot of people, they're really odd. It's really odd, but they'll also be like, oh wow, that makes sense. Did I lose you? I think I got you back.
Hey Stash. Yeah, sorry about that. Let's do a quick sound check. You know, my phone just died.
That's okay. You sound perfect.
Okay, good. Good.
Excellent. So with all this all trail stuff, what kept you, I mean, of course, being one with nature, did anything else keep you motivated to keep pursuing the all trails and keep pursuing stuff going barefoot, really?
So, gosh, I'm not even sure how to start. Motivation is just not the question.
All right. Excellent.
It's just not the question. If you the chance to get out in the Catskills and explore areas that I haven't seen, you have to chain me down to keep me from wanting to do that every single weekend. So the only thing that stopped me, you know, I have other commitments and things I have to do, and I work during the week, but and you know, the snow and the ice that blocks me. I can deal with a little bit of snow, but you know, I'll tell you something. Cold weather injuries are very painful.
Yeah.
You do not want to have a cold weather injury. They hurt like hell. So that's the only thing that really blocked me.
Awesome. Crazy. So any close calls while hiking barefoot?
No.
Really?
No.
Any close calls?
Except for snow and ice.
Any close calls while hiking with shoes? Any close calls at all?
Well, what do you mean by a close call?
Like something like almost an injury or a possible time you didn't think you'd make it off the trail where you'd have to call for rescue or something like that?
Well, hey, you know, I was running in Minnewaska several years ago and there was a trail junction. Three trails came together and they were all blazed the same color. So I thought I was going this way, but I was going this way. And I came back and I went that way. And I actually had a call for help. And
really?
I was late and got in trouble with the family. that's the only thing I spent 4 years in the Army, so I wasn't any kind of, you know, super trooper, but it's good training. You know, it makes you careful, pay going out in the Catskills and elsewhere, you know, like it's an operation. So there's a planning phase, there's an execution phase. I tried to do what Mike Sudi did. I tried to do a diratissima. Mike Sudi went out and ran all 35 peaks and I forget the time, it was 50 odd hours, and he set a new record. And I actually saw him on the trail coincidentally, and he looked fantastic. I tried to do that and I made it through 23 of the peaks.
Oh wow.
And then I was self-supported, so or unsupported even.
Yeah.
So it started to rain. I didn't have any shelter and I was tired. I did not want to go up Rusk in the rain at night.
Yeah.
So I aborted and got rescued by Smiley's taxi. Oh. Thank you, Smiley. But so I felt even at that point, that was like 3 days into it, you know, I was pleased that I still had, you know, the right judgment to make the right call. So I wasn't at risk at any point, although that was disappointing, but so no.
Well, that's awesome. It's great to hear that. It's great to hear that you are very, very safe on the trails and stuff. And, you know, the call on Rusk, you feel disappointed, but you're also like, man, that was, you don't want to get into that situation, especially when it's raining and cold. It's hypothermia weather. Yeah. Sometimes it's just not the cool stuff.
I agree. You can get cold very quickly. And, you know, I've been out hiking through the forest in the 50s and it's raining. And I've got, you know, after a while I'm cold. I put wool long johns and, you know, a fleece underneath the Gore-Tex, which of course ends up leaking. So I went up on Mount Washington in the summer. But if I go up on Mount Washington, even in the summer, I'm bringing all, you know, a down jacket, wool top and bottom, Gore-Tex top and bottom. So, you know, I don't like to play games with the weather because I get cold easily. I'm better in the heat, I would say.
Agreed.
The heat can be dangerous too. So I, you know,
staying hydrated is key. Staying hydrated at all times, but also, you know, the cold can screw you up really bad.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. But I would say, as I look back over the years, you know, I think driving is a lot more dangerous, honestly, than being out. You know, the Catskills, the mountains, that's our natural environment as people. That's where we came from. So, you know, some people get hurt, and, you know, people get into trouble in the Catskills, but they can get hurt, but it's not a lot of that, honestly, even for all the people who aren't, you know, necessarily that experienced.
True. I will agree with that. Any times while doing your ultra challenge or anything else, did you feel like you weren't going to achieve it? Like there was too much on the trail telling you to get the hell off of the trail right now. You're not going to do this.
Well, that would be going up Panther. So I was just about done. And you know how the all trails works. You're like, well, I was redoing a lot of it to make it all barefoot. So I was like, you know what? I've been up to Panther a dozen times, but I always went from the Giant Ledge direction. I'd only been up once from Fox Hollow. So I had to go back and redo that. It was mid-April, nice day. So I raced out there and made it up to about 2,500 feet, and then there was snow. and then I was like, well, you know, I've got 1,000 feet to go and a couple miles. So the prudent decision there is, you know, put on your shoes or turn around. Of course, if I put on my shoes, it wouldn't count towards the barefoot challenge, right?
Yeah.
So I kept going. And by the time I got to the top, it was, you know, deep snow and just ice covered ledges. And I was, but I made it to the summit, and then I put my shoes on to go back, and I did not injure myself, although that's what I would consider to be pushing the envelope a little bit.
Yeah, Fox Hollow is a great trail. What a fantastic trail.
Yeah, and so I'd only been up, that was only the second time. I've only done that trail twice.
It's very long. It's way longer, but it's more, yeah. I think it's more enjoyable because it's gradual. It's got the bumps that you hate, but it's still beautiful trail.
Yeah, I agree.
So with liking all this all trails challenge, do you have a favorite trail in the Catskills?
Well, you know, the official answer would be no, because, you know, I think I love them all. And the great thing about the all trails, again, it gets you out of the, you know, the obsession with the high peaks, which, you know, a lot of us start that way because peaks are very meaningful. But what I discovered, you know, is there's so much water. You know, consistent with your observation about the mud. And so there's so many cool ponds and waterfalls that I would never have gone out to except for the All Trails Challenge. By the way, I would never have gone out to see Catskill Falls in 1,000 years except for All Trails, because I was, you know, I thought you had to park on the highway and get trampled by tourists. And I didn't even realize there was a route down from the top. But just to answer your question, I thought of, there's one trail I keep thinking of, and I think it's the Trout Pond Trail, but it's Russell Brook Falls.
Russell Brook Falls, nice.
And I just remember that I thought, wow, that's a really cool waterfall. And it made an impression on me. And I stopped and took a few pictures, and I still remember that sort of jumps out. So maybe I'd say that's my favorite spot or favorite trail.
That right above that used to be an old mill, correct? Or that actually, that falls was an old mill, correct?
You know, I don't know anything about the history there.
Okay. I remember visiting that place and I was just like, wow, some of this part looks artificial, and then it looks like it actually, I guarantee, I mean, all these brooks with good flows used to be old mills. So most likely.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. People would have built there. Yeah. There's a tremendous history, and obviously, you know, Mike Kudish and his work on the history of the forest. And I only have a very superficial understanding, but every now and then, you know, you can see whether it's the plantation or it's just an old, you know, all the old tanning roads or bark roads that are now trails. Yeah. It's, can you imagine people? I mean, just imagine how difficult the farming would have been.
Oh God. I always think of that. Like I read from, I'm pretty sure it was like a week or two ago in one of my sessions, one of my episodes, I read something about how farming went up to as high as 2,600 feet in the Catskills. I was like, what the hell? Like, it's crazy.
Somebody from the Open Space Institute quoted me some stats, and these may not be right, but I think they're directionally correct. I think he said 100 years ago, or maybe it was 150, Ulster County was 2% forest, and now it's 98% forest.
Wow.
Now, that may be a little bit exaggerated, but there's some pictures of the day. There's a great color video of John Burroughs from 1918, and you can see he's at Woodchuck, I think it's Woodchuck Lodge, Roxbury, and you can see behind him, yeah, the mountains are bare, yeah. Absolutely bare, just the for tanneries. A little bit of forest up at the top.
Yeah, it was all the tanneries, and then all of a sudden, you know, these farmers had all this spot to be available for them from all the trees being wiped out, so they used it.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things that I sometimes think about, I met Jim Bowden on the trail the first time coming back from Southwest Hunter. So he told me about the history, and you know, Southwest Hunter was naked back in the day. They cut down all the trees, and they had that, I guess, a coal-fired engine and maybe a sawmill at Devil's Acre lean-to, and they cut them up into pieces and then shipped them down the ravine. So it's beautiful to see how that's all grown back. We have a great success story in the Hudson Valley about preserving the land. New York has really done a great job.
Agreed.
With that. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the Fenwick Logging Company up there that used to be on Southwest Center.
Yeah.
Wicked story. I'm going to try to get Dr. Kudish on here to talk about that.
Oh, yeah. Well, if you do, I will be tuning into that one. He's just so knowledgeable about the forest. It's really extraordinary.
Actually, probably after you, I'll just have him on here for the rest of the time.
Yeah.
Him and Ralph. Yeah. Him and Ralph.
Yep.
Yep. Excellent. Do you have a favorite view in the Catskills?
Oh, so yeah. So a favorite view, you know, I love them all, but the one that popped into my mind is if you're on Wittenberg's Western. Now, hang on a second. Let me think. I think it's Wittenberg. Wittenberg. I was thinking of Twin. So if you're on Wittenberg's summit, now, if I get this wrong, one of your listeners is going to call you up and then please reach out to me and set me straight. But I believe you can see from Wittenberg, pretty much south, southwest, 50 miles away is the Monument Tower at High Point State Park, which is where the Schwangunk Ridge Trail starts, junction with the Appalachian Trail, and 70 miles, slightly more to the west, is the Delaware Water Gap. So to me, one of the cool things is to be on some of these high points in the Hudson Valley, and the Schwangunks are fun for this, and Scudamunk is fun for this. If you get to these vantage points and you can see the landscape and how things connect, and I always just think, you know, back in the day, people didn't have Google Maps.
Yeah.
Right. So this is how they figured things out. And, you know, we all have that special feeling, but that, I guess that would be my favorite.
Hell yeah. Yeah. And you're correct. You can see the High Point in New Jersey and you can see the Delaware Water Gap. I always remember taking pictures from there and from Ashokan High Point. You can definitely easily see the High Point of New Jersey right in there. It's really cool. So yeah, Wittenberg is one to be remembered in your mind, stuck in your mind forever. So awesome. Same. I'm a twin kind of guy. The southern side of twin is my favorite.
Twin is awesome too.
Yeah. So excellent, Ken. I think that concludes it, man. I appreciate you joining with me. I really do.
Hey, Stash, this was fun. Thank you so much. I appreciate the chance to talk with you and share some of these thoughts. And by the way, to any of your listeners, by the way, if you're curious about Barefoot, you can reach out to me through my website. I have a website, Brace Yourself. I was lucky to snatch up this URL. So it's www.barefootken.com. And, you know, my view is not that everybody should take off their shoes, but I think there would be more people who would enjoy barefoot hiking if they gave it a try. And so glad to, you know, give people some pointers or help them find their way. It's really that simple. It's natural. And it's particularly fun if you want to do something when all of a sudden you're not in a hurry and you want the experience rather than you need to get from point A to point B in a hurry. So, so that's there if it's helpful to people.
Nice. Well, excellent. Do you have a suggestion for a post-hike brews and bites? Do you have any place to suggest that where you go to eat after a hike?
You know, I don't know if people will think this is the most imaginative, but you know, I go to Brios.
Yes, agreed.
Right. I go there and hey, it works. And by the way, if you come down to the Schwangungs, I'm going to give a shout out to Cafe Mio. I love Cafe Mio down in Gardner. That's more of a morning place, but they have great omelets and other breakfast foods and lunch too.
Excellent. That'll be on there. And I will suggest Oakley's in Arkville. Awesome stuff. Awesome burgers and drinks. But thank you, Mary Cheatriot. I think Tree Trail, Mary T, whatever. She's going to hate me for this, for that suggestion. That's really good stuff to suggest local businesses and stuff like that. Get them a little bit extra. So, Ken, thank you for joining me once again. Thank you to the sponsors that have donated. Thank you very much. Thank you to the donors. Actually, I forgot to say that Catskill Adventures donated today 3 coffees. Thank you, Catskill Adventures. I got a shirt from them that shows the path of the devil's path, and it says devil's path on it like that. Really awesome shirt. So thank you. I'll put them in the show notes. Definitely. I really thank everybody who's listening. Subscribe on any platform. Look me up on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I have a website. If you have the time, shoot me a review on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, whatever platform you use. Ken, you have a Facebook, an Instagram, and a website. What's your Instagram again? Do you have one?
Instagram is Long Brown Path.
Long and Brown.
Again, you can find all of that stuff. I'm also on Twitter under the same handle, and you can find all that stuff at barefootken.com.
Awesome. I will put that everything in the show notes that you mentioned tonight. Got it written down right here. Always got to write it down. So thank you, Ken, for joining me tonight. Please have a good night, and hopefully see you on the trail soon.
I hope so, Stash. Thank you.